Welcome to There's Sometimes a Buggy Irresistible Opinions About Classic Film. I'm Elise.
I'm Dave. This week we return to the Acteurist Oeuvre-view. It's Lilli Palmer. We're getting into the latter half of the 1950s. We'll be discussing Teufel in Seide, The Devil in Silk, and La Vie à Deux, Life as a Couple. We did, unfortunately, fail to secure
many, many films. There's like a big gap between these two films.
Yeah, the ones that she made with Carlos Thompson. I either couldn't find them or I couldn't find them with subtitles, and they're in German, so that doesn't help us, unfortunately, as we are not sufficiently versed in that language.
We're not at all versed in it.
We will be doing Mädchen in Uniform, Les Amants de Montparnasse. Those are coming up next, maybe on other lists. They appear slightly before La Vie à Deux. Rest assured, those have not fallen by the wayside, but several of the West German films definitely have, sadly. Maybe one day we'll get a chance to see them and we can reinsert them into the narrative of our podcast. Yeah, Between Time and Eternity looked really good, and I just couldn't find any way for us to watch it and understand it.
Could have watched it, couldn't have understood it. We did have that one issue with our Ritwik Attack episode where the subtitles were
sporadic.
So sporadic. The only discussion we were able to make of the film was our attempt to understand what was happening in it.
Yeah, that's not ideal.
No, we don't want to do that again.
The Devil in Silk.
I like this. It was a good melodrama.
I loved it. I thought it was amazing.
It's a variation on themes from Leave Her to Heaven, the German novel it's based on, which was actually translated into English, called The Devil Next Door by Gina Kaus, predates the source material for Leave Her to Heaven. I mean, there could be a film-to-film influence, who knows? But obviously, it had a lot of resemblances to Leave Her to Heaven in terms of story and thematics. Some similarities also to The Suspect, which we just watched.
I can see that.
Interesting to think about what would Leave Her to Heaven be like if Lilli Palmer were playing the Gene Tierney role. Well, we sort of find out here. For one thing, it makes it more evident than ever that Leave Her to Heaven is, as we said in our recent episode on it, it's a study of Gene Tierney's persona. It's a study of Gene Tierney's beauty in technicolor and the possible amoral implications of that. One thing I noticed very different about this movie is in Leave Her to Heaven, even though Tierney's character is very clearly a villain, nevertheless, the movie does lead you to adopt her point of view and sympathize with it in a limited way. This movie, I feel, never invites you to do that, but Palmer's performance does.
Hard distinction to make.
In Leave Her to Heaven, like we were saying, there are scenes where the viewer is invited to become as annoyed by the people around her as she is. There's no framing like that in this movie.
I can see that. It's basically everyone against Lilli Palmer. She's certainly a paranoid character, but she's not wrong if she's thinking that her sister and her dad and everyone at the company that she owns, they're all against her, really. Maybe she's made it that way and it's a self-fulfilling prophecy and it just gets worse and worse. It's a vicious circle.
Yeah, but to me, there's such a discrepancy between the way she plays this character and the reactions of the people to her. Even more so, although that still exists in Leave Her to Heaven, but even more so than in Leave Her to Heaven, where it's this study of this abyss of Gene Tierney's face, like we were saying. Here, she's playing a character, and the character is a neurotic.
No, she's suffering.
But she doesn't have that kind of archetypal power of the Gene Tierney character in Leave Her to Heaven, where you could maybe sort of believe these mythical things people are attributing to her. But no, this just seems like a suffering, neurotic woman. That's where she seems more like the wife in The Suspect, but of course she's also Lilli Palmer and very beautiful and charismatic, right?
We could split the difference there, because the movie is certainly capitalizing on the glamour of Lilli Palmer. That scene early on in his reminiscences where where he goes to the party to introduce him to society, and he's watching her in the mirror. I mean, that mirror carries a lot of weight throughout the film. Gets smashed at the end. Smashed by her. You know, she has destroyed her own ability to ensorcel at that point. That's what the movie's going for in that scene at the party. Can't even look at her directly. He has to look at her reflection. She is being presented to us as an irresistible force at that point.
But she just seems so much more of a character with an understandable internalized psychology than anything Leave Her to Heaven is going for, right?
It may be due to the structure of the film, it may be due to the source material, but also the actress. Of course, Lilli Palmer is going to manage to give us a person here in the void that Gene Tierney occupied.
Right, and to the extent that Gene Tierney could, obviously she's not as good an actress as Lilli Palmer, to the extent that she could give us that character, not sure that that's what Stahl is going for.
Exactly. So it worked out perfectly for that film, and I think in this film, I don't know the filmmaker. I do know Kurt Jurgens, because he appeared in at least one movie I've seen, the Nicholas Ray Bitter Victory, which is a great movie.
He was also in the remake of The Blue Angel, but I haven't seen that.
Oh, right. No, I haven't seen that either. I think this movie, we both immediately thought of Leave Her to Heaven, of course. Interesting that the American film has heaven in the title, and this one we've got the devil.
Devil next door. We start with some real expressionist flourishes.
Yeah, I think this stuff is really beautiful. I mean, It's mostly in flashback, the film. There are a few present day sequences at the trial and just before and just after, but so much of it we're being shown through memories that are evoked and dreams. That first meeting between Kurt Jurgens and Winnie Marcus, basically the Jean Crane figure in this film, she's not a sister. There's also a sister who's against Lilli Palmer in this one.
Yeah.
But there's a third person in this story. He meets her the same day that he meets Lilli Palmer. So there's all kinds of fateful stuff going on. You could see how dreams could get bound up with that, although the voice of Winnie Marcus is always kind of telling him, you're over-dramatizing here. This dream is simplifying a very complicated matter. And I guess maybe that's part of what dreams do sometimes.
Well, if there's a simplification here, then the simplification is that him having this initial layer of anxious memory right after he's had this terrible showdown with his wife, believing that there was immediate love between him and Winnie Marcus, and her voice is saying, no, that's not how it went at all.
No. In fact, you did fall in love with Lilli Palmer when you met her on a train, and you didn't start to have these other feelings until that relationship was in real trouble.
Yeah.
That first scene where we see Lilli Palmer in the dream is amazing, too. She just walks in to the train compartment, has a vicious look on her face in the dream.
Well, that's the thing. Like, I was going to say, initially, when we go through this prologue that ends with Lilli Palmer turning up and destroying his work, right? Making him lose his symphony, which actually does happen, but not as symbolically as the dream presents it. You think that there will be a fairly straightforward story in which she is the villain, and you know, the title also leads you to believe that. Everyone who knows her, kind of other than her husband, talks like this is the case, right? That she is a straightforward villain, but that isn't the portrayal. That isn't the way that Lilli Palmer portrays her.
She should be someone who's making decisions based on her own psychology rather than on the needs of a plot, and that's how she comes across.
Well, yeah, and it could also be a directorial choice.
But in the dream, yeah, she clearly came in there just to fuck up his life. And that's how he sees it after the 3 years have elapsed and the roller coaster marriage has run its course.
Now, we should talk a little bit about Lilli Palmer at this stage, because I think she is just now, and it's great seeing these European films where actresses in their 40s who are still beautiful are still being able to play glamorous love interest roles, right?
Yeah. So
it's not something you practically ever see in Hollywood movies until plastic surgery got a lot better in recent years. I feel like she's really just coming into her own in film with these European films in terms of having a style of acting all her own. It's obviously not a studio created persona, but a presence that's all her own. And we talked about it a little bit discussing Fireworks the last time, but it's gathering a little bit as early as the Four poster, but she just has this, I mean, I think it's something she's obviously developed through working in theater, and we surmise psychologically surviving her marriage with Rex Harrison, and also acting with him a lot, she has a supernatural poise, right? That can almost seem like dissociation. So it works really well in neurotic roles. Actually, that was true as early as...
Beware of Pity.
Beware, that crazy Beware of Pity movie.
Her final British film before coming to Hollywood.
And here, where she's playing this disturbed and hysterical woman, like, coupled with that poise, there's this impish and pixie-ish quality that she has, right? Which is not what you expect in either a glamorous seductress or a femme fatale.
Yeah, and that's certainly going to continue to be part of her arsenal. I haven't seen a lot of the movies she made from this point onward, but it's going to figure into The Lovers of Montparnasse, Les Amants de Montparnasse, certainly in But Not For Me. That's a Hollywood film that is going to make use of these qualities.
And she's never afraid. Like, in this movie, she is never afraid to go for the big theatrical gesture. Stylized performance, right?
Not when it's called for. She's ready. We haven't really said anything about the story. We don't have any Leonard Maltin guide either to give us a blurb on it. So we'll spoil things right now. This is a story about a man who met two very important women on the same day, marries one of them, Lilli Palmer.
Marries the wrong one, which is a very foreshortened version of what happens in Leave Her to Heaven, right? There's a much longer dance of him choosing to marry the wrong woman.
The reasons that this was the wrong marriage for him come out over the course of his flashbacks and in other people's discussions of their marriage as well. She's a very rich and powerful woman. He is a practically penniless musician who's been surviving by playing piano in bars and giving music lessons. He had aspirations to be, you know, one of the great lights of European music, but it hasn't come to pass. So there's a difference, right? Because...
Well, we did talk in Leave Her to Heaven about how Gene Tierney's aggression and desire toward Cornel Wilde, and even her overall attempts to isolate and stifle him and take his work away from him, all of these things align her with a more masculine role. Part of the problem he's having with her. But here it's much more obvious, right?
Yeah, well, it's a much bigger imbalance in the relationship. In Leave Her to Heaven, Cornel Wilde is a best-selling author. He has money. That's not the problem. She still doesn't want him to have any friends or family or anything else to call his own. But she can't take away the fact that he has his own independent source of wealth. That helps to build in some sympathy for her, right? Because as you're watching it, you're like, just stop complaining about this woman who has so much more money than you and is willing to share it with you. Just enjoy it. That's what I'm thinking. But then you start to see, okay, well, it's not just masculine pride. I mean, and that's the slow burn of the film.
Well, he does own up to it too, which throws some sympathy back to him, right? That he says, well, maybe this... I am just having ego problems or whatever.
Right, but that's the point of it all, right? That it's in doubt for quite a while, or it seems to be, are these alarms that are going off for him legitimate or not? You know, looking at it from a more enlightened gender perspective than would have been typical at the time.
It's more, much more than in Leave Her to Heaven, it's like a gaslighting construction, right? Not knowing whether, because he even says that, like, this should have been a red flag, this should have been a red flag, I should have realized I was in an abusive relationship at this point. Circumstances, not her in particular, but circumstances keep gaslighting him.
Well, no, she's doing it a little bit too, for sure. I mean, she is lying to him about what she's doing, particularly in her sabotage of the musical protege that he takes on.
Well, like... yeah, that doesn't happen for a while, though. So yeah, first of all, we get these arguments over money, over her always paying, and he tries to take her to to a dinky little restaurant where he's always gone as a penniless artist and been fed on credit by the nice owner.
It looks like a great little place. It's like a Greenwich Village kind of dive in a Hollywood movie, right? Like maybe the place in Seventh Victim.
And Lilli Palmer is rude about the food, but at the same time, at this point, you're still a little sympathetic and being like, well, but why should she have to eat crappy food just because of your masculine pride? This isn't what she wants to do.
That was amazing, though. She tells the waitress...
It was filling. It was very filling.
Can't you...
Well, not the waitress. That's not the waitress. That's like the owner.
Yeah, well, she's both, right? She is serving them the food, too. Thank you. It's very filling. Yeah. Wow. Don't say anything at all if you're going to say that.
But she's mad at him.
Yeah.
And at this point, you can still be like, well, maybe she's a bit of a bitch, but maybe maybe it's just because she's angry at him and he's putting her in this situation unnecessarily.
The other stuff, he's objecting to her finding him a job as someone who doesn't like putting effort into getting a job. You know, I would happily take any job anyone was willing to get for me.
Sure, but at the same time, part of his objection to this is something you should be able to sympathize with, is that he doesn't want to be working on this end of music because he thinks it's going to, you know, it's too close to what he wants to do without being what he wants to do, and he thinks it's going to ruin his creativity, and it does seem to be suffering.
Yeah, well, it definitely does. He doesn't write any more music for the rest of the film after that, so that winds up being true. His resistance to this administrative post at a record company that, okay, technically she doesn't own it, but she owns more than 50% of the shares. She tries to evade that at first, but he's looked into it, and she's like, oh, you've been doing some detective work, haven't you? So, publicly traded company that she owns de facto is the same thing. He's like, well, but they still, you know, they still wouldn't buy my concerto.
I wondered if it would come out that she had ordered them not to buy it.
I think that's what you kind of have to assume.
Either that, or like he says, they are interested in commercial music. And that's...
his music is not. Yeah.
Yeah, exactly. But yeah, you would think that she has enough power that they would just buy the damn...
Yeah, just put it out at a loss. Anyway.
Yeah, exactly.
And how much of a loss could it possibly be in the grand scheme of things for a company like that?
But then we get the scene where she is specifically jealous of even his sporadic attempts to compose. So that's back to Levered Heaven territory.
She tells him, like, this is basically an insult to me. You leave our room and you go out to compose music? What's going on here? It is eroding his love for her, little by little. But he's definitely, as you mentioned earlier, he's the only one sticking up for her, really. Because the rest of her family are just, they feel sorry for him from the beginning. Like, this poor guy has married the insane Lilli Palmer.
Oh yeah, her lawyer is the only one other than him who stands up for her, and we're led to believe by the fact that he has a sexy portrait of her in his office that this is because he's in love with her.
Well, no, it's not just that. He was engaged to her, or he thought he was.
Right.
And she threw him over.
Well, that's exactly from Levered Heaven, so yeah. I don't understand. Was this plagiarism by the author of Levered Heaven? By, what was he doing, plagiarizing a German novel?
I seriously doubt Ben Ames Williams read any German novels.
Well, then that's why I wonder if there's some movie-to-movie influence.
It's really interesting to look at them side by side. You could possibly get a book out of it, analyzing all the different ways this narrative comes to the screen on either side of the Atlantic. And finally, while things are starting to go south in this way, I mean, this is after she has torpedoed his budding friendship with this young composer.
Oh, but no, wait, no, we have to do the... After the first party that she throws for him, where we see him looking in the mirror, when he's still very much enchanted with her, at the end of that party, that's when her live-in maid collapses. And her reaction to that is so insane. She's just doing it... Oh, she'll get up in a minute. She's going to regain consciousness. She's just doing this to ruin my mood, because she doesn't like me to be happy with any new man, because she was so devoted to my late husband. It's like psychopathic, but at the same time you're like, well, maybe it's a maid who's psychopathic. Who knows?
Yeah, and Lilli Palmer really beautifully underplays that to the point where you could see how he's able to get past this. It should be a red flag, as you say. He shouldn't still want to marry this woman at that point. But he definitely does continue down that path and does marry her after seeing this exhibition. But yeah, she doesn't scream it.
Well, that's what is so psychopathic about it, that she does this so glibly.
You have to assume that he thinks, well, maybe she's got a point. Maybe this is a weird psychodrama between them that I'm not privy to yet.
Although, yeah, and then he asks, well, why do you keep her then? So I'm expecting this to develop into some kind of Rebecca and Mrs. Danvers relationship or something, but that's not quite it, no?
No, it's not quite it. It really just is. I mean, Lilli Palmer does depend on this servant. She likes having her around, as we see at the end.
She monologues to her, even though she gets no sympathy.
No, and the servant, yeah, I mean, we certainly find out later, she is gravely ill. she has cancer and she needs surgery, which Lilli Palmer just keeps asking her to, can you just put it off? Because I'm feeling sad tonight. So don't go to the hospital for your scheduled operation.
She can't bear to be alone when she's in one of her fits of anxiety.
Yeah. Kurt Jurgens helps her up, helps her back to her room, her servant's quarters. And then the evening continues.
And then he goes on to be like, and then maybe I really should have taken it as a warning sign when she took all of my belongings and put them in the attic.
Yeah.
Well. Oh, but before that, we get the scene where he is going to, he wants to share Plato's dialogues about love, the symposium. He wants to share this with her, right?
But all she's looking at is, well, there's an inscription on here from one of your old girlfriends, so fuck this book.
Now, if I saw that, I might, with my brand new husband that I passionately loved, I might be like, oh, who's this? Oh, tell me the story of this. Oh, meh, meh, meh. But I wouldn't be tearing it out of the book and crumpling it up. So it's just this, it's a violation. This is his belongings. These are his memories, and she is just violating them.
Yeah, it's definitely a red flag. So Sophie, the maid, later tells him, you know, just keep it out of her sight. Keep it up here. She considers everything that gets in her way as quote unquote stuff.
Well, yeah, anything that is his, which means anything at all from his past.
And she did this with the previous husband as well. He was exiled to the attic. So it's a pattern.
The episode with the young composer is interesting. This is the first time we see her being kind of elaborately manipulative instead of just having a fit in the moment.
Out and out lying.
We're also seeing him, though, and this helps create unreliable narrator doubt. Imagine scenes that he's not in, right?
No, that's true.
In this episode. This relationship is important to him because he feels like he's not achieving anything in this role. All he's doing is rejecting people. He can't create anymore, but finally he finds somebody worthy of mentoring, and that can be a way that he can make a contribution to the art.
And he tells her about this in an excited manner. She meets him. Lilli Palmer's character is named Melanie. She turns on the charm for this young artist, and she gives a party in his honor, just like the one she had given for Kurt Jurgens. Now, I don't know, in other movies it could be, okay, well, she's planning to throw the old man over for this new young guy, but that's not at all her plan. She really is a one-woman man. She's fixated on Kurt Jurgens for the duration. She wants to get rid of this other young man, and she comes up with a pretty ingenious way to do it by pulling him aside, getting him to see things from a very sinister perspective.
And she actually pulls out, this is the stuff that he is imagining her saying, right? He wasn't witness to this scene, and he never gets a secondhand report of it, exactly. She actually uses lines that he has said to her that she has retained and been bitter about. How music has to come from the heart and not the head. How you have to be alone. Now, this is the part. This is the part that she's so bitter about. How you must be alone in order to hear your music.
Is your work going to have any integrity if you let Kurt Jurgens edit it and shape it? And of course, the young musician starts to think about this.
She's gotten so inside his head, and this was throwing me back to when I lived in an arts community and there was nothing going on except constant people getting inside of each other's heads and making you think your work was good or making you think your work was bad or making you question who you were collaborating with or trying to establish or break up collaborative relationships. It was just, yep, it was like this. Everybody was Lilli Palmer. Probably I was Lilli Palmer too.
As you say, I mean, he is imagining this, so we don't know exactly how the real conversation went, but yeah, the way he pictures it, she is filling the young musician's mind with doubts about the motives operative behind the scenes in this mentorship. She's also flirting with this guy, attacking his mind in multiple ways. Whatever she did, the upshot is that the guy never communicates with Kurt Jurgens again, even though they've been working very closely on this exciting musical project that he brought to the company.
Right, and the idea is that he just can't have any enjoyment in life that isn't about her.
No, not at all. He can go to work as long as it's a dull, dreary administrative job. Absolutely no fulfillment is coming to him. If something threatens to ignite the spark of the artist within him, she must crush it down. That's not what she tells him, because he confronts her. That's an amazing scene. He comes home home from work after having learned that something along the lines that he's imagined anyway. He gets some kind of confirmation that the artist was warned off working with him.
And he's finally starting to get angry at this point.
They're not alone. Melanie's sister, Sylvia, is there. He gives Sylvia a little kiss on the cheek and he wants to just sort of brood by himself, but Melanie just prods him until he finally lashes out at her. And this has never happened before. Him right. yelling at her in front of her sister who's on his side always.
And she still manages to get a good line in there, Lilli Palmer, right? As she's walking out of the room, right? Oh, sure. If you'd like to stay and tell my sister all about it, by all means.
You guys can plot against me as so, you always are doing.
Even at this point, the movie is still making you feel like, you know, maybe she has a point in some of the things that she's saying.
And again, she's not like a Disney villain. I mean, she goes in the other room and always she's crying over there when she does that. And she's genuinely hurt. And she's not just doing it performatively. She does some other things performatively, as we learn. But
yeah.
She's not coldly calculating in her emotional response to these things. I mean, she falls apart when he turns on her like that.
Yeah, so this is very different. From Leave It to Heaven, obviously, this neurotic side of her, right? Where she, and this is where you start to feel the discrepancy between the way other people are describing her and not just the performance, but the character, the way the character's written, because this seems like a neurotic who needs help, right? And not like some mythical monster who's pressing everybody to death or some terrible egotist.
I think the movie does get at that, right? Because while everyone else certainly has always thought of her this way since she was a child and probably helped to ensure that this is how she was going to be as an adult. Kurt Jurgens,
he starts to pity her.
Exactly. That's what he highlights. It's not that he starts to hate her at this point, but his love is ebbing away because he sees her as a sick person that he can't have any kind of a relationship with at this point. She's not a real partner in their marriage. She's just one giant neurosis.
What I think is good about the way the arguments between them are written is that although her reactions are very exaggerated, they're not, these sorts of arguments aren't completely alien. Like, they're within a wide ballpark of the kinds of fights people do have. You've done this thing, you just don't love me, you mm-hmm. just want to have your own way, not wanting to be left alone, not wanting to feel unloved.
Yeah. And of course, the thing that really brings all of their problems into focus, Winnie Marcus comes back into the film. She is a temp and she happens to get an assignment as his secretary because his usual secretary has broken her leg. And he sounds happy on the phone when he hears that news. She'll be out for 4 weeks. 4 weeks of Winnie Marcus. He already likes her. Now, again, he's projecting backwards in his dreams. But this is obviously someone that he took a shine to when he met her on the beach. He's happy to see her again. She's a breath of fresh air. She reminds him of a freer time in his life. She is just a winning person.
And the fact that he mentions this change and seems happy about it is enough to set Lilli Palmer off.
Not only that, she comes to see him at the office. Winnie Marcus tries to stop her from going into the office. They have a little confrontation and she buzzes him in and it comes out that he's got a nickname for her, Nightingale. I mean, this is enough to set Melanie's mind racing.
That's right, I forgot about that scene. And then she says it over and over again, "You're Nightingale."
Yeah, she tries the carrot and stick approach to getting rid of Sabine. That's the Winnie Marcus character. The day after this happens, he's getting ready for work. She gives him a gold watch, very expensive gold watch, and mentions that this is the anniversary of their meeting on the train, June 21st. It's also the anniversary of his meeting with Sabine. However, she doesn't know that. He accepts the gift gracefully. We don't see wounded egotism that he showed early on in the relationship, you know, whenever she offered him any kind of expensive gift or favor.
Well, what he says to her early on is, "It's not just about my male ego. Relationships should be about giving and not just taking." Once he no longer loves her, he doesn't care if he's taking and she's giving.
But he does still love her at this point, starting to ebb for sure. But the next thing she does really does damage their relationship, probably beyond all repair, because she says, okay, could you just do one little thing for me? I gave you this.
Oh,
can
yeah,
you give me the firing of Winnie Marcus?
Oh my god, yeah. Because it's this, because he's still, even at this point, he's ready to be happy if she can just let them be happy.
He's genuinely not contemplating having an affair with this pleasant secretary. Not at all. And even after she does this to him, but he's like, no, I'm not going to get rid of this woman just because you say so. In fact, I'm going to keep her on just because you said so.
Well, who is it? Is it the sister or the maid? I can't remember. I think it's the sister. The sister tells him, you have to break her will. You have to stand up to her because otherwise you're just going to die like her previous husband because he never stood up to her.
Yeah.
And so he's actually trying to take this advice.
He is, yeah. So you can see that. That's in the background. He's not being peevish about this. I mean, he genuinely likes Winnie Marcus. He doesn't want to throw her out of work.
He's happy to throw the other secretary out of work.
Well, no, not necessarily. He said he was going to find somewhere else for her to work in the organization. And I believe him. I don't think he was going to take this old woman who was just in the hospital and leave her with no salary. But he definitely was willing to send her to another part of the business. At that point, he's like, no, that's it. She's staying. You just deal with it. And the way she deals with it is a suicide attempt.
But according to everybody, not a real suicide attempt.
Yeah, the doctor says, well, we pumped her stomach out and there were about 4 pills in there. That's not enough to kill someone. And we've seen her do stuff like this before.
Now, a lot in this movie, the trial really turns on the question of, would somebody who'd made multiple suicide attempts, or
fake attempts,
is that somebody who will or will not eventually commit suicide? Now, as far as I know, multiple suicide attempts are in fact an indicator, and not a counter indicator, for eventually committing suicide.
Well, I agree. It's a cry for help, for sure, whether you take baby steps to the ultimate decision or not.
And the movie seems to fulfill that.
It puts the lie to the pop psychology that is indulged in the courtroom scenes.
I suppose I could understand if you hated your sister. I suppose I could understand believing that, you know, she's just going to be faking this for the rest of her life. Actually believing that this was just fake to get her own way.
Yeah, well, of course. And people say this all the time, even now, despite how much more discourse there is about suicide and the prevalence of it and the horrors of it in our society. You get a lot of talk like this. But he takes it seriously. Everyone tells him not to, but he does dismiss Winnie Marcus.
Well, we learn that her last husband, that he died because
He had a heart attack.
He found her after a fake suicide attempt.
Yeah. And right. It was too much for him. Whatever people say to him, he's like, no, I'm going to have to give in on this. But that's when pity becomes the only emotion he feels for her. So it's a Pyrrhic victory.
Yeah.
He starts an affair with Winnie Marcus after this point. This is what drives him to it.
Yeah, and also once she starts realizing that he feels pity for her, that's even more horrifying to her than anything that's happened so far.
That's pretty galling, yes, for someone. Well, for anyone, I would think, but especially for someone like Lilli Palmer.
Now, unlike in
this movie.
Now, unlike in Leave Her to Heaven, we never find out what her attraction to this man is, why she is so fixated on him. I suppose it doesn't matter. It is interesting, though, like even in a movie like compared Leave Her to Heaven a bit to Cat People, there's always some reason that the woman gets a fixation on the man that you can understand. But here it just seems like anyone she happens to fall in love with, she's going to do this to.
It's a pattern. I mean, he's an appealing guy, I think, but she could find other people if she wanted to. But no, she really is set on Kurt Jurgens, and I guess just something about that initial train conversation really got her. Yeah, there's no going back.
Well, she said she, I don't know if I can actually make anything thematic out of this, but she said it's because she made him lose part of his symphony, right? She says it's because she wanted to make that up to him.
Well, sure, initially, but it had to be more than that. And she doesn't seem like someone who would care about that kind of thing most of the time, right? She certainly doesn't care how much she inconveniences poor Sophie or her family.
Well, that's why I said I don't know if I can make anything thematic out of it. It's just not a question that the movie looks into at all.
No, it just takes it for granted that these kinds of sparks can fly for whatever reason.
So can sheets of music.
Yes. And we do get a sense of the kind of life he's leading in his extramarital affair. It certainly seems a lot more fun and pleasant. They take little trips to the country. They meet up in their favorite cafe. They do spend time at her flat, which I find really cozy. Dangerous, obviously. If Lilli Palmer gets any sense of this going on, yeah, then you could start to picture it going the way of the suspect. And it actually does get to that point when she discovers the love letters between them. This is the inciting event for the death of Melanie. I was a little bit torn. I wasn't sure if it was going to ultimately reveal that it had been a murder somehow. I was thinking actually the sister might have murdered her. I mean, I think the movie gives you a little bit of a sense that that's possible.
Or the maid. The maid comes up.
Yeah, it's explored. I mean, that's what Winnie immediately thinks. This is a woman that wouldn't let you go to get your cancer surgery. Maybe you just got fed up of this and killed her.
Or maybe it would turn out to be the lawyer somehow.
Right.
Who knows? Because he was, yeah, I don't understand how that could be the case, but who knows? Plenty of suspects.
My money was either she really did kill herself or her sister killed her.
Really?
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't know. I was wondering about the maid because she's very much highlighted as a suspicious character early on. The scene of greatest pathos for me in the movie is her final scene with her maid, and I can't remember exactly what she says, but again, she's talking about how no one loves her and how alone she is. The way that Lilli Palmer plays that moment. It's not outward to the audience as I'm showing you a villain, I'm showing you this hysterical person who's trying to manipulate other people. She's showing she really believes this. She authentically believes this.
Of course. I mean, she has no other reason to try to keep Sophie at her apartment.
And Sophie has no sympathy. This older maid figure, you know, the archetype is that this person in a story should be giving sympathy to the young woman who relies on her, the younger woman, right? The mistress. And she gives her nothing. And that discrepancy actually gave me sympathy for Lilli Palmer, right?
Even though you know she's begging her maid to forgo life-saving cancer surgery.
And is that just the casting? Would it be different with another actress?
Yeah, I think so. I mean, it really works. It really is a feature of the film that it can still do this right at the end of the line for Lilli Palmer's character, where she's going to make all this trouble for everyone. I mean, the analogous scene in Leave Her to Heaven is certainly not told this way. It's just Gene Tierney coldly deciding, okay, my next step here is kill myself and have all the fingers pointing to my sister, that bitch.
Yeah.
She doesn't make any desperate pleas for understanding or company to help her stave off this blackest of possible moods.
Well, no, even when the attorney in the court scene describes what she must have ultimately done, I mean, there it's almost going too far when we see a flashback that fits his description of events. It's almost going too far in making her pathetic, right? But before that, there's that balanced moment of just your realization that this woman really feels these things and has made everyone around her so fed up that there is no one in the world that sympathizes with her.
No, unfortunately not. As you say, this is a recreation for the jury and the judges of Melanie groping on the floor to find, does she have enough pills left to actually kill herself? I mean, that's crazy.
That's the classic melodrama trope. I actually put it in a play once.
Oh, really?
Groping for pills on the floor.
Kurt Jurgens is partially responsible, and he feels it. This is part of what's been weighing on his mind, that he discovered once again, or he discovered definitive proof of her motivation. Modus operandi with these suicide attempts. She'll take a pack of 12 and 4 in her glass, which is enough to knock her out and make her seem like she needs medical intervention, but not enough to kill her. And the other 8 she'll just hide somewhere for later. And he finds them while he's looking for these letters, because she has done something really horrible and threatened to bring legal action against Winnie Marcus.
Right, that's the suspect motive for murder. Right?
Yeah, just ruin her life, bring everyone down. And instead, now the letters were gone, but he finds these other pills, and he's so furious that he puts the pills on the bedside table to show her, I know that you've never even been sincere about trying to kill yourself.
But what he doesn't know, I mean, it is interesting, they bring this up at the end, the defense lawyer brings this up, and that's when he starts questioning it himself. Unconsciously, was he trying to push her toward actually killing herself?
Yeah, right? And he doesn't know how to answer that, because it's possible that, you know, he can't rule that out.
It's also plausible, though, that he just really believes she's never going
to
do it.
Yeah, of course he does. He has to think that, right? That this is an unreasonable person who's doing unreasonable things. That's been the whole problem with our marriage. And at that point, he has made every concession that he's willing to make. And now he just, yeah, he wants to win with a gesture. And this is how he seizes upon doing it, exposing her.
And the way that the situation resolves, like her trying to get her way, get her will, resolve with her other husband, is he just died, right? So there was no... It seems to be the only resolution to this for her is for somebody to die.
Yeah.
But this is the other thing I was thinking of, right? Talking about how Lilli Palmer's persona changes the meaning of this character, because when all of these characters are talking about how this is really the issue here is her will, right? She wants to achieve her will and nothing can stand in its way. When the characters talk about Gene Tierney and Leave It to Heaven, the way that whole movie is constructed and the way her persona is used, which is her appearance and to some extent her ability to act on screen like a bit of a zombie, you believe that, right? You believe that this is about this woman's assertion of her will, as well as lots of other things that mitigate that, that we talked about, right? Other social circumstances and psychological circumstances. But here, you don't believe that of this character at all. At all. She's too, like I said, elfish, and she's too fragile.
Yeah, I agree. Pathologizing and showing us a person genuinely in distress at the center of this horrible dilemma, while making it pretty easy to sympathize ultimately with everyone's desire to get away from her.
Well, it's easy to sympathize with him, but I don't find it as easy to sympathize with all these people who are just kind of preaching about her.
Well, but we're not following Melanie the early years, right? Obviously, they've all been through similar things with her.
Of course, but that doesn't mean the movie dramatizes it in a way that makes me sympathize with them. With the maid, you can see the maid's point.
Yeah, definitely. The maid has not been treated very well by Melanie, despite the fact that, yeah, Melanie clearly doesn't believe that she has been a cruel mistress. She thinks that there's some kind of bond between them, but yeah, there isn't, as we find out. There really isn't. That scene where Winnie Marcus goes to visit the maid in the hospital and sees her after the surgery is pretty amazing, actually.
And she's begging her, like really hoping this woman turns out to be the murderer.
Can't you just tell me that that's what happened? But no.
Well, no, because she explains it and she's like, yes, I've had these thoughts, but that doesn't mean you're going to act on them.
Yeah, there's a wide gap between having these thoughts and acting on them.
Well, she says everyone on Earth would have killed everybody by now if there wasn't that abyss between thinking about killing someone and doing it.
It's very nicely expressed. Winnie Marcus, this is where she goes and plays. I really liked her performance a lot. Her reaction to that non-confession by the maid is pretty powerful as well. I mean, it feels like all hope has been lost here. Like Leave Her to Heaven, this is a movie where the courtroom scenes actually work, I think, and are useful parts of a movie, which is not always the case.
Well, yeah, but in very different ways. Like, Vincent Price is the whole courtroom scene in Leave Her to Heaven.
Yeah, no, in this one, I mean, Kurt Jurgens, when he makes his confession, it's incredibly powerful. He was really great in this movie.
Yeah, I usually don't like shouty actors, but his shouting was really great. Like, there's so much frustration, emotion, justified anger.
It's a pretty convincing portrayal of a man who, like, he really does want to do the right thing. He seems to be a genuinely caring person, and he's trapped in this situation where, I mean, he's driven a woman to suicide, and this other woman that he's fallen in love with is having a miserable time too.
Right, because he has to pretend that they never had a serious, and she therefore also has to pretend that they never had a serious relationship.
Yeah. Pretty fortunate that Jurgens has hired an excellent lawyer who manages to summarize things in a way that convinces the judges that, yeah, a person as selfish and egocentric and amoral as the Lilli Palmer character has been described can still be so sad that she will kill herself. I think it's really important too that this is a major deviation, because in Leave Her to Heaven it's really just
revenge,
a final gambit to try to implicate everyone and burn the world down. in this case, no, it's just Melanie can't deal with life anymore. She can't go on living and puts an end to things. She has no thought of, they're going to convict him for killing me. No.
Well, that's why it's important to understand about the character that her greatest fears here are abandonment and that no one will love her.
Yeah. And
she has made it come true.
She's absolutely correct that no one in the world cares about her at the end, and she acts accordingly when she has ascertained that. I thought it was a truly great movie, and I didn't know what to expect, but that was awesome.
Yeah, and it makes so much good use of what Lilli Palmer can do, everything from brittle charm to neurotic hysteria to this vulnerability that's also important to the character, right?
Now, La Vie à Deux, well, this was quite a problematic film in a way, ultimately. So we're skipping ahead a couple of years. We're back in France. This is an all-star film. So Lilli Palmer has an important role in it, but only for, you know, the first third of the film, let's say. You looked into this. So the credits announce it as the final film of Sacha Guitry.
So Sacha Guitry was a middlebrow French and very prolific French playwright.
Wasn't he sort of like a Noel Coward of France?
Well, much more prolific than Noel Coward. He did also act, yes. I was thinking more like, but still more prolific, but someone more like we were talking about earlier in the Lilli Palmer series. Terence Rattigan, but even like much more of a force.
His work was very popular.
Yeah, in addition to writing, what did I see, over 100 plays, he also made many movies as a writer-director.
Yeah.
Clément Duhour?
Yeah.
Is the director here and co-writer. He was a frequent collaborator of Guitry's. On his Wikipedia page here, it says, after the end of the Second World War, Clément Duhour becomes Sacha Guitry's regular producer and collaborator through his production company, CLM, whose name is meant as a quasi-acronym of his first name. This association would prove fruitful in the 1950s with the production of a series of cinematographic masterpieces. So apparently these movies have a reputation.
Well, we'll have to explore them one day, maybe.
Yeah, maybe this should be a special subject. Like the cult classics Three Make a Pair, Lovers and Thieves, or If Paris Were Told to Us.
So am I correct in assuming that Guitry was dead by the time this movie was made, and this is kind of a tribute to him?
I mean,
that's how it seems.
Yes.
And Pierre Bresser is playing a Guitry figure, and that sets in motion the plot.
Just to give some numbers, he wrote 115 plays.
Wow.
And Wikipedia says, from the 1930s to the end of his life, he enthusiastically embraced the cinema, making as many as 5 films in a single year. Prolific, a prolific guy.
Definitely.
But yeah, so this is Boulevard Theater, middlebrow light theater, right? It's not experimental. It's not highbrow. It's not upper class.
No, it's not new wave, that's for sure.
Conservative theater. So yeah, Terence Rattigan seems like a good... But when we actually looked at Terence Rattigan, English Without Tears wasn't that conservative.
No.
So that was interesting. But this seems more like what it says on the tin.
I mean, the cast is amazing. So obviously people wanted to take part in this tribute to Sacha Guitry. I mean, you got Lilli Palmer, that's why we're here, but we also have Edwige Ferrier, we've got Daniel Derrier, we've got Pierre Brasseur playing the author.
Well, yeah, like I said, he was a huge force in French theater and cinema, and I don't know, maybe the messy aspects of his writing, maybe he's a figure comparable to Dickens, I don't know, because I don't read French, and I'll never be able to read his plays, so... Who knows?
Well, I guess I could read them, but I have not, so I don't know. I don't know how typical... We started watching it, and I realized what the plot was going to be like. It's sort of Brewster's Millions kind of situation, right? Someone's dying. They've got a weird will. The whole plot of the film is going to be who's going to wind up emerging victorious in this sweepstakes to satisfy the strained requirements of a dying man.
They don't even know they're in the sweepstakes, though.
No, they don't. And it turns out that it was all a bait and switch anyway. We are introduced to the plot problem and some of the characters in the author's office. He's got 2 dumbass detectives who are going to be set loose. There is the executor of the estate. Who was that actor? Because that guy was amazing.
The notary?
Yeah. Louis de Funès. That's like the funniest performance in the movie, I think. That guy was having so much fun.
Says on his Wikipedia, he is France's favorite actor, according to a series of polls conducted since the late 1960s, having played over 150 roles in film and over 100 on stage.
Oh, really? Oh, that's fun. He was getting the most unexpected glee out of his scenes, I thought. We've got, you know, other professional associates of the author who stand to inherit his fortune if the romantic couples that he based one of his favorite plays on have fallen apart in the meantime or are no longer happy. And it is one of the maxims espoused by this author named Pierre Caro, who's supposed to be a Sacha Guitry figure.
Well, he's written a book. It's not a play, but...
Right. He doesn't really believe that people can be happy together. He felt like he was proven wrong, at least momentarily, by four couples. And if they've maintained that level of happiness, then they're going to get to inherit his fortune. That's what his will is detailing.
One of the characters, I don't know if this was one of the author's maxims, but one of the characters says something about, that we were wondering about at this early point in the movie. Infidelity is the, what does he say, the only reason a woman stays in a marriage, or
it's the only link back to her husband, I think, le lien, I think they said. So
it was translated differently.
Oh, that. I wasn't reading the subtitles this time at all, so I don't know what they said.
Something along the lines of the only thing that keeps a marriage together for a woman.
Right.
And certainly there's a lot of infidelity going on in this movie.
There is. And a lot of it does seem to help bring the couples back together in weird ways.
Right. And the, you know, as opposed to a typical farce, let alone a typical Hollywood movie, there are no consequences to these women in cheating, and there's no moralizing about their cheating.
No, that's the whole point.
Yeah. But
the most amusing thing about the structure of this film is that nothing that happens in it matters. Right? Because at the end, he reveals that there was nothing to inherit, and this was all just something to keep everyone occupied while he died, it seems.
The vignette structure, particularly with the way it builds structurally, despite the fact that it's episodic, so that we get the really racially weird comedy couple.
Oh, yeah.
Right before the climax. Well, they're not racially weird. The sequence is racially weird.
Yeah.
Right before the climax of the very big emotional climax. So you get these sort of light comedy scenes of infidelity that are played by Lilli Palmer and Daniel DeRieux. And then you get this bizarre, lowbrow anecdote sequence where the vulgar joke, which is a joke that I don't think anybody, unfortunately, can, of my generation anyway, can grow up living in this world without having heard some variation on, where the woman gives birth to a baby that is not the race of her husband.
Yeah.
And then, after that, and I think, although I'm sure an audience of the time would have been laughing uproariously, I think it is meant to be uncomfortable comedy.
Well, I hope so.
Though maybe not uncomfortable in the same way we now feel uncomfortable. But then after that, there's a very, very emotional sequence that's also unexpected. For some reason, the way that it was all constructed and put together was reminding me of all things Holy Motors.
Okay, maybe. Who knows? This may be something that Kerax has in his bag of tricks or in his bag of inspirations. I knew something still had to happen because we had not seen Edwige Ferriel yet. And she comes in right at the end as the ex-wife of Pierre Caro. And yeah, it is kind of a moving encounter between them at the end. And nothing else in the film has been moving. A lot of it had been funny in the first two sequences. The Caboufig couple, which is the third couple, man, that was pretty fucked up. But yeah, let's go through them one by one, at least to some extent. And especially, so our first sequence, well, actually, there were four couples. One of them is disqualified right off the bat based on a vignette.
So this is another trope or over, like the racial joke, this is another over-familiar trope, obviously, which is hating your mother-in-law.
Right.
So we start with the comedy sequence, then we start with the low comedy sequence, then we get two high sort of comedy sequences with the upper class characters, then we get another and more uncomfortable low comedy sequence, and then we get the emotional climax, right?
Yeah. So the Lilli Palmer sequence, she is the wife of a government official.
Yeah, so this is our second, after the mother-in-law joke, this is our second sequence.
Yeah. And this is one that actually has to be investigated by these two clownish detectives. And they are being interfered with by the two guys that are going to inherit the money if none of the couples turn out to be happy together at this point. What they're trying to do is unclear anyway. They lure the detectives away to Montignac, to another town. What are they trying to do exactly, though? They're just trying to gather more information, maybe so they can frame something up to make it look like they're not happy, but then they fall into the fact that, oh, well, there really is something weird going on here with Lilli Palmer and her husband. So then they want to bring the guys back. So they shot themselves in the foot by sending the detectives to another town.
I have to admit, I was not paying very much attention to the framing device.
Yeah, ultimately, that's good because it was all a misdirect. What these guys are trying to do, you know, they're just incompetent. Everyone's incompetent at the fringes of this movie. And Lilli Palmer, her story is that she's a performer. She gets to sing in French in this movie. And
Are you sure? That didn't sound like the same voice or like her voice.
Well, it might not be. You're right.
Fireworks. This was sounded more like an operetta singer.
More polished. Yeah. Yeah. You might be right. It might not really be her. But they have her character performing anyway. This is all part of a weird night for her where she gets a new valet. Who gradually it comes out he was dismissed from his previous position for having sex with his mistress, his boss.
This is really funny.
Yeah.
Her and Gerard Philippe, they worked really well off of each other, don't you think?
Yeah, no, that was great. He presents himself, everyone's all a Twitter, they love this guy, the other servants, they're getting the room ready for him, they can't imagine why he wouldn't be hired.
Well, they also think he's good looking.
Well, that's what I mean, yeah. Lilli Palmer, too, is charmed by him, but when she calls for references, she's told, well, I had to let him go because he committed an act.
Well, I mean, much like an act, yeah. Much like the racially weird sequence, this whole sequence, although played as frothy high comedy, is also based on a vulgar joke, right? That's what it centers around.
You know, while we were watching it, I wasn't sure. I didn't have a sense of the shape of the movie at that point. I was like, okay, well, is this some ringer that's been hired by the editor and the publisher guys who are trying to make her commit indiscretions? But no, it's just an accident that he comes along at this time. He just keeps, at first he's like, okay, well, if you can't hire me based on my references, I guess that's good to know. I won't give this woman as a reference anymore. But then he won't let it go and he barges back in on her and he says, you know, can you please tell me exactly what she said? Because this is all too vague and I'm being torpedoed without knowing what my accuser is saying. She says, well, she didn't really say anything definite. And we saw the conversation. And that's true, right? When we first watched it, I was like, what was told to her there? Why is she? But yeah, that's the point. She wasn't told. And she just assumes it was theft. This is the jest that he committed.
And of course, he can't actually explain what happened without sort of sexually harassing this new would-be employer.
But he's like, well, now I know that I just can't, no matter what happens, I can't have sex with my boss. Even if she seduced me.
Well, yeah, she called me to her bedroom in the middle of the night and she pretended that her sash was broken or whatever.
So he's basically saying, you know, now I know, even if you try that on me, I won't do it. So we won't have this embarrassment to deal with later. So isn't that a good thing? You know, you could get drunk around me and maybe throw yourself at me and I'm not going to take the bait. And she's been very aroused by this whole conversation, even though he tells her at the end that she's not his type, and that's also to the good.
It turns out that she doesn't have anything to do with her wanting to be faithful to her husband, but I guess she just doesn't want to get involved with a servant.
No, she's so horned up by all of this that she goes out and plans an affair with a magician, played by Jean Marais. You know, she manages that with no trouble at all.
Right, and this is another tour de force sequence that shows her particular qualities as an actress and as a comedian, because the way that she just, this character orchestrates this assignation, right? Inviting Jean Marais over and he thinks he's going to be giving a big performance at a party. And then he finds out, oh no, it's just you and me, is it? And yeah, he quickly gets a picture, but she just takes all of this in stride with aplomb, right? this seduction that she's undertaking. And then to actually get her to sleep with him, he has to do some seducing of his own. So he starts in the heat of the moment. They both get caught up in this romantic future, traveling the world that he's planning for them, right?
Yeah, he talks about, you know, we'll go to London, we'll go to Edinburgh, we'll go to Norway. And don't worry, even though it's March, it's the cold countries where you're going to be warm in the winter. Then we'll go to Cairo. It's all going to be very exciting.
And we think that this is all, like, the way that she's planned this one night stand with this magician, that it's cheap and tawdry sex. But of course, this is a French movie, and you don't have cheap and tawdry sex in a French movie. You have the art of love, don't you, right?
Yeah.
Even when it's just sex. And so the next morning, he's still talking to her about how they're going to leave right away, but she's like, oh, you don't sound like you did last night. Now you sound like this is just practical and a chore and not this wonderful magic carpet ride that was described to me. And she realizes that he doesn't want her to go anymore. And right, and if he's not going to be super enthused about it. But it's more than that. It's like, it's about the art of seduction and how she, even though this was her plan, she still needed to be seduced. And she needed to be seduced, but she doesn't really want to run away with him. But still, because of this mutual seduction that they've undertaken and this night of magic that they've created, and they're talking about it, they're being meta about it, they're talking about it philosophically the next morning, the parting with him actually affects her. And that's like the best moment. You know, the crowning moment of the whole thing when her husband comes home and I don't even know how she explains that he's there.
He came to see her because he felt bad that, you know, the performance had to be canceled the night before.
And the husband somehow just accepts this. But then he says to her, and then she starts crying. And he says, oh, is this because I left in a huff? Well, look, I came back.
Yeah.
And so we are sharing this moment of vulnerability with her, allowing herself to be moved by the romantic experience of this one night stand. You know, it's all very, now I'm starting to get why Sacha Guitry is actually a great writer, because it's all very complex, isn't
it? Yeah, well, this was the best sequence in the film. And it doesn't end there, because then you've got the valet, Désiré, which is a male name.
Oh, right.
With no E at the end, right? Usually you see Désiré with accent aigu and so it's a female name. But yeah, this guy is just named Désiré, and he's having dreams and talking in his sleep about having sex with Lilli Palmer, and apparently she's doing the same thing.
Right, and her husband, again, is just like...
He's very understanding.
Yep. Oh, we can't control our dreams.
And they both resolve to not sleep in their rooms that night because they're embarrassed by this, and they don't want to be overheard grunting about having sex with the other. And they meet up unexpectedly on couches in the living room. And then they're discovered by these comedy detectives who we later find out don't matter.
And of course, nothing other than the racially weird sequence, none of these episodes are actually about the relationships between the husband and wife.
No, not really, except that the husbands are all very understanding, and you can see why, because they're all totally out of their leagues with these women.
I think they're also sleeping around. Well, not, yeah. Although, you know, there could be a double standard for that, but...
Well, we certainly know that about the Caboufigs, the last couple. In the other cases, it's not so clear, but it's certainly possible that the minister...
Not the last couple, the racially weird couple.
Yeah, that is the last couple.
No, there's the Edward Fier.
Okay, well, yeah, but I'm not thinking about them.
Oh, okay.
They're not part of this initial group of happy couples. Right.
Sure.
But yeah, that's where we leave Lilli Palmer and her new valet, and we don't know what's going to happen later on.
Or maybe we do know.
Is her husband going to keep being understanding about all of this, or is there going to be a limit at some point? We have no idea. I don't think we ever got a sequel, so we don't know. The next sequence is Danielle Darrieux, and she is semi-involved for 3 months with a guy that wants her to become his mistress, or wants her to cheat on her husband with him, but he never comes out and asks her to do that.
So they have quite a lot of banter about this.
Yeah, she's playing cards with her husband and some other people. I think they're playing. He pokes his head out from behind a curtain and is like, psst, I mean, everyone's watching, and she goes into the other room with him, and they have this long conversation about how it's inevitable that she's going to give in and embark upon an adulterous affair with him. She says, no, I think you're wrong about that. He explains his reasoning, which is that, you know, no woman would encourage a man the way you have, or accept the attentions of a man the way you have, unless they're eventually going to give in. And she's like, well, I disagree. I haven't been doing that.
Well, no, she says, I've been giving in just because it's easier.
But she says, you know, I have not encouraged you to love me. He says, well, you have, you know, kissed me at least once. And she's like, oh yeah, that time in the car. He's like, well, I just wanted to see how far you would go. It turns out that he went from Rue Royale to the Champs-Élysées.
I mean, obviously, the idea is that they are doing a verbal dance, and yeah. In fact, she has been encouraging him.
Her objection to his method of seduction is that he's been predicting that she will give in to him without actually offering himself to her, really. And that's what she says has been the problem all along. Right. She was willing to have an affair with him if he had just actually said, do you want to have an affair with me? And he never did.
Right, and now he does, and then she says, oh, it's too late.
Yeah, I've already made up my mind now. You've been annoying about this for 3 months, and it's over. And then he's like, when people talk to me like this, I get pretty out of sorts. I might go out of my mind. I don't know what I'm going to do. And she's like, well, what do you usually do? And he's like, well, I slap people. And she's like, oh, really? You slap people. Are you going to slap me? And then he does.
So this is actually quite artfully constructed, because they've been flirting. She's annoyed by him. She's decided, no, I'm not going to go to you now. Also, we're talking about it in a much too logical a way. If you're just going to talk to me logically, I needed you to declare yourself, but if you're just going, we're going to do this in such a logical, mechanical way, and it's going to end with you going, oh, so you are interested in me, okay, come to my room tomorrow. No, that's not going to happen. But then it's the slap. He slaps her, and then there's this, obviously she wants to slap him back, but she can't because her husband comes in. There's this whole absurd, lengthy sequence with the husband trying to intervene between them. And it's the waiting she has to do, and the subterfuge she has to use in order to slap him back is what gets them so horned up that by the end of the sequence, she agrees.
Yeah, the husband is instrumental in all of that as well. He plays his part. He wants to get to the bottom of all of this. He just assumes that the slap had gone the other way.
Right. But he has some very strange ideas about how to take care of your wife slapping your acquaintance because he's been forward with her.
Well, he says, you know, this reassures me because we've all been wondering if she was having an affair with you for the past 2 weeks or more. But since she slapped you, I think that's conclusive proof that it never happened. And he does say, you know, you marry a beautiful woman.
You don't do it to be at peace. That was the English translation.
Yeah, yeah, I think that's basically what he says. Yeah, I mean, you know you're in for some excitement when you do that. This is the kind of excitement you can expect. Now, you insulted her a little bit, let's be honest. But, you know, was it worthy of being slapped? Let's figure this out. And when the prospective lover says, I think we can all agree that I would not have lunged at her and tried to kiss her while her husband was in the other room. That would be stupid. So she overreacted and slapped me when she didn't need to. I was just talking.
And then it looks for the longest time that she's going to get another slap.
Yeah. And the husband is like, oh, well, now this is a problem. Our side, we overreacted. Our couple. Now, does that mean we're going to have a duel or slap each other, punch each other? But no, l'amant, the lover, wants to slap her. You know, the husband agrees. This is probably for the best. Don't hit her hard, but okay, you can do it.
Yeah, and we're definitely set up to feel like this woman's going to get another slap. And yeah, that there's something faintly wrong about that.
Yeah. But then she seizes the moment. The husband's not looking and she gets in a good whack.
He's like, oh, that was too hard. She's like, no, it sounded worse than it was, holding her cheek.
But then that reestablishes the possibility for the infidelity to proceed.
You know, I was not laughing that hard watching it, but these sequences are constructed as well as to be or not to be. They're pretty good.
Yeah, they're very funny. The first two. The last sequence of the people that might inherit, this one, it was seeming dubious from the beginning and it just got worse and worse. I mean, I actually laughed a lot about the initial argument that they were having because he's saying, yeah, I have to go. I've got an affaire d'automobile, a car business in Spain. And she's like, what the fuck is car business? And he's like, this is...
Well, yeah, you have...
Make cars and people distribute cars and they get together and conduct car business. Yes. And that's where I'm going. And I don't need my wife around my neck while I'm doing that. And she's like, so I'm around your neck, am I? And I mean, they're just... I mean, how could this couple have ever been an exemplary marriage that was written about in La Vie à Deux?
But no, apparently obviously, the framing device is absurd.
Yes.
Yeah, so this is a middle-class couple, they seem like, compared to the upper-class couples we have met before this. I think the first couple was probably, you know, with the mother-in-law living with them. With the middle-class couples comes the lowbrow comedy. And I have to say that this actor, whoever he was, what was the name of the couple?
Oh, it was Fernandel. Yeah, he's a famous actor.
Fernandel? So yes, he was very funny. And yeah. The whole sequence where everyone is trying to stop him from going into the bedroom and discovering that his quote-unquote child is black, his reactions were very funny. And obviously the thing that's going through your mind is how the hell are they going to resolve this? And no, but the setup is insulting enough. But the resolution is...
It's unbelievably sick.
Mind-boggling. Mind-boggling.
We've talked a lot about North American racism on this program, because that's mainly what we've been dealing with, racist North American films. But this was just a reminder. Europe, even though many African American performers found a refuge there at various times in their lives, I mean, it's a deeply racist society as well.
But he is trying to kill you, as James Baldwin kept saying in those documentaries that we watched recently and discussed on the podcast. They're not, you know, constantly trying to literally kill you, but that doesn't mean they're not racist.
Yeah, I mean, this joke, yeah, it's something I'm sure was on vaudeville all the time. Yes. And
well, like I said, everyone knows this joke, at least in my generation. I'm hoping if any younger people listen to this podcast, I'm hoping this is your first, but now you know too. Now you've heard the joke too.
The way it's resolved is even more demented, right? Because
demented. So I was trying to figure out what we're supposed to think the psychology is, what we're supposed to think really happened. So as far as I understand, he does in fact realize that she's had an affair, but he wants to spare her the shock of discovering that the child isn't his anyway.
A lot of it is unspoken, but I mean, it's pretty vile stuff here, right? So she's angry at him for going to Spain and conducting car business, and she's had this admirer, a sailor from Norway. She goes out to have sex with him just out of vengeance, but she must have gotten really hammered that night and slept with someone else. She's not even sure exactly what she did. It turns out that, yeah, she slept with a sailor from a different part of the world. As that's starting to come back to her, she's deeply concerned about what's going to be revealed in the delivery room. Part of it is, yeah, it'll be definitive proof that this is not her husband's child, but also it just seems to be racist concerns about, you know, having everyone know that she had sex with a non-white person. I don't know how else you can frame it, and the way everyone is so...
No, but he says he's... So they go off, and this is the very dehumanizing part that's so shocking.
Yeah, he just gets rid of this child.
And gets a white baby, like a random white baby. Although there is a good joke later on about, you know, it actually could be yours.
Yeah.
Because you've been having sex with everybody.
If someone from Spain, from the car business, dropped off a baby, well, this could be yours, yeah.
Right. But his idea is to go back and get the black baby later, after she's recovered and she can process this. But then he gets attached to the white baby.
No. What happens is that he sees how relieved she is.
Oh, right.
Because she gives this whole speech about how when she saw her baby and she saw what the baby looked like. And I mean, she mentions skin color. How pink.
Yes. But she also talks about how their marriage was renewed as soon as she knew it was his.
Yeah. But that is, I mean, it's so fucked up. I mean, there's no saving this sequence, really. Her son is gone, like, has been just given up to adoption, who knows where, and she's never gonna have any link with this baby. And I mean, and nobody seems concerned about this. I mean, that's really appalling. And maybe the movie's trying to make you think about how fucked that is.
No, it's
fucked
not.
Up that is.
The movie's not. I don't think the movie is.
I don't think so either, no.
But, as we've said before, when we've encountered really, really racist material in these movies that we've done for the podcast, even if the writer is not trying to call your awareness to anything, sometimes the structure of the joke or the structure of the melodrama itself calls your attention to it.
Well, like, sure.
And is supposed to be uncomfortable in ways that can mean different things to audiences at different times, right? So I think maybe the discomfort at the time might have come out in hysterical pissing yourself laughter, and now the discomfort is experienced in a different way, but the discomfort is there in the structure of the thing, right?
Yeah, this woman will never see her child, and he thinks that's all for the best. No one's ever going to tell her what happened.
And the plot, I mean, like I said, it's there, the discomfort is there in the structure, because the plot specifically calls for him bringing this baby back, and it never happens.
Because he thinks, I really did a good thing when I swapped in this white baby, and it would be cruel to reveal now.
What is the resolution then? The resolution is that instead of him being upset about being cuckolded, it's all deflected onto the shared bond of their racism. Yeah. That is what brings them together, isn't it?
Yeah, yeah, which is what makes it so sick.
Yeah. And it's not even overt racism. Like, the sequence is trying... Like, there's a whole discussion about the baby and how the baby is...
The baby's great.
The baby's great. The baby's fantastic. Yeah. It's just not quite what you ordered.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
That's fascinating anyway.
It is. It is. I was certainly not expecting to have to deal with that.
Why wouldn't you, in a Boulevardier play from a writer of the early 20th century in France?
Yeah, you're right. It's just a reminder. And then the film concludes with a moving sequence between Edwige Feuillet and Pierre Brasseur.
Very, very moving.
This author who's been masterminding all of the foolishness that occurred for the first, 85% of the movie, is now on his deathbed, sends word out that he needs to see his ex-wife before he dies. And she is happily remarried, or she thinks she is happily remarried to this other guy.
This other guy, it transpires, was his friend and betrayed him by running off with his wife.
Yeah. He obviously committed indiscretions to make her want to do that. I mean, I think that's pretty clearly indicated. She had reasons for wanting out of the marriage. But now, to his credit, the second husband does, although at first he doesn't even want to tell her about this, he finally does relay the message, and she says she has to go to see him.
But he knows that there is still a love bond between these two, so he permits only an hour.
Right.
And she can't, obviously because of those feelings and because this man is dying, she can't adhere to a schedule.
No, and when she gets there, Pierre Brasseur tells her that, this whole life that you've been leading with husband number two has basically been a gift from me, because...
Well, yeah, he opts to destroy her marriage on his deathbed, basically.
He does, yeah, which is not the kindest thing to do. I guess it leads her out of a fool's paradise as well, possibly.
We thought this was pretty solid when we first saw them interacting in this sequence.
She's kind of done with, both husbands now. Husband one is dead and husband two is a fraud. And I guess Edwige Feuillet hopefully will find someone better at some point. And that's kind of where we leave matters.
It's this very interesting movement from this focus on this initial couple and this relationship that seems so solid and loving and romantic, and watching that just dissolve in front of our eyes, right?
Happiness is fleeting. Now, we don't have any Fear and Movie going in Toronto this week. Going to be a light month movie going wise for us, because we're packing to move. We are moving April 1st, and most days we're going to be spending at least part of the time putting DVDs and books into boxes and wrapping up Christmas ornaments and doing all kinds of stuff like that. But we're going to keep right on to our schedule otherwise, and I'm sure there'll be plenty of cinema going once we're settled in our new place. Next week, we're back to the Hollywood Studios Year by Year, MGM 1946. This is going to be a Jules Dassin double feature. Two movies he directed in Hollywood, A Letter for Evie and Two Smart People. I really like both of these movies. Looking forward to watching them with you, Elise.